As weird as it sounds, the past year's events no doubt would have aroused some familiarity to people who have played the game Plague Inc. And as overly simplified as the game's representation of disease transmission across the world might seem, it actually almost matches one of the most common models for disease spread in the fields of epidemiology. The game uses an example of a compartmental model, meaning that each individual is put into one of several compartments, with the ability to change state and travel between these compartments. While Plague Inc. uses compartments of healthy, infected, and dead, compartmental models come in many more different shapes and forms in the fields of epidemiology. This is Inspecto, and this video will cover some of the things that mathematics and epidemiological models can teach us about disease spread. We'll first look at some of the most commonly used models, explore some of their useful applications, and finally, verify our findings using both a virtual simulation and statistics for the real-world example of measles. To represent a virtual population, let's simulate 1,000 dots wandering around in a box aimlessly, representing 1,000 people. This is, of course, not very accurate to real life, but it approximates human behavior on a larger scale well enough, while providing simplicity, which makes it easy to simulate and model. Let's start with the most basic compartmental model, SIR, which stands for susceptible, infectious, and recovered. Blue is susceptible, red is infectious, and gray is recovered. For every unit of time that a susceptible dot is within a certain distance of an infectious one, it has a certain probability of being infected, and infectious dots naturally recover after a set amount of time, at which point they are granted permanent immunity to the disease. This functions the same way as Plague Inc.'s healthy, infected, and dead model, but the game's representation is, of course, much darker. For the exact reason that people may die, the R compartment is sometimes referred to as removed instead of recovered, but let's use the term recovered. Let's take a moment to think about a model with only S and I, meaning that people can never recover from the disease and will stay around forever to infect others. In this case, the whole population will eventually be infected, with infections initially rising exponentially, but slowing down as the proportion of susceptible people decrease. This creates what's known as a logistic curve. However, in the SIR model, people are only infected for a limited time, specifically 20 days, before they recover, just like many real diseases, which makes things more complicated. Most importantly, this means each infected person can only go on to infect a limited number of other people before recovering. Now, there are way too many variables that determine how much the disease spreads, like rate of contact, hygiene, how contagious the disease is, and how long it takes for people to recover. But for the purposes of modeling the population, we can ignore all these different variables and only measure one metric that ultimately gives us the most important information we need to know. How many other people does each infected person pass the disease to during the duration that they were infected? This value is known as the basic reproduction number and is represented by R0. Note though that passing the disease to someone is not the same as creating a new infection because that person might already be infected, in which case they wouldn't become a new case. The number of new cases each infected person creates can be found by multiplying R0 by the proportion of people who are still susceptible, which is represented by S. For example, if you are infectious with an R0 value of 10, but only 40% of the population is still susceptible, then on average, out of those 10 people, only 4 will actually become new infections. This means that as long as R0 times S is larger than 1, or in other words, S is larger than 1 divided by R0, each infectious person will create more than one new infection, and the infectious population will continue to increase. This is the first application of these epidemiological models, finding out how many people need to become not susceptible in order for the infectious population to stop growing. For example, for an R0 value of 3.5, when S dips below 1 over 3.5, which is about 29%, meaning when 71% of the population is not susceptible, the infectious population will start to decrease. This is what's known as herd immunity. That doesn't mean there won't be new infections though. It just means that the new infections are less than the new recoveries. The actual final amount of people that will have been infected at some point or another, in other words, the final proportion of recovered people, follows a relation with R0 that looks something like this. Compared to the susceptible proportion at herd immunity, much less people actually come out unscathed. Here are some simulations with other R0 values, and we can see that they all have their infectious population start declining when S hits 1 over R0. By the way, in order for these simulations numbers to stay more consistent, it's actually taking the average of 10 simulations in the background, only one of which is getting drawn to the screen. Numbers are also getting rounded to one decimal place, which may be the reason for any inaccuracies. The next model we'll look at is the SIR with demography model. The basic SIR model assumes that the disease occurs on such a small time scale that new births and deaths from old age can be neglected. However, some diseases are around for so long that it becomes necessary to take into account the births, deaths, and age structure of the population. Let's make a tweak to our simulation in that every day, each person has a 1% chance of dying, and every death is immediately replaced by a newborn susceptible person. First of all, this means that there is a constant stream of people from all three categories getting replaced by susceptible people. Secondly, this means that the probability of any person staying alive for n days is 0.99 to the power of n, since each day the probability of staying alive is 99%, resulting in what's called an exponential distribution of both the age of each person and their final lifespan. This is more accurate to real life than a model where everyone has the exact same lifespan, and while the populations of developed countries generally don't look like this, if you look at the population pyramids of developing countries like Ethiopia, which diseases are also more likely to run rampant in, you can see it does match with the aforementioned exponential distribution. More importantly, the reason we want to distribute age this way is that some of the applications we'll cover later only work with an exponential age distribution. When we run the simulation, the infectious and recovered population begin to decline after the first wave due to the new susceptible births. However, after a period of time, the remaining infectious people start spreading the disease again in more waves, each wave smaller than the previous one. What's happening is the state of the population is oscillating back and forth in a damped oscillation curve, converging to what is known as an endemic equilibrium. As opposed to an epidemic, where the disease rapidly spreads, an endemic involves a disease that stays present in the population in the long term, with an infected population that more or less stays consistent. Here's where the first application we covered about herd immunity can be even more useful, because newborn babies often get vaccinated. Assuming that at some point during the endemic a vaccine is developed, what proportion of newborn babies need to get that vaccine for the disease to eventually be wiped out? Well, this proportion is equal to the herd immunity non-susceptible proportion of the population. Let's add vaccination to our simulation after the first wave on the 140th day, with vaccinated people represented in green. In the previous simulation, the value of S at herd immunity is 29%, which tells us that approximately 71% of the population has to be immune for it to be eradicated. Now, in the simulation on the top, the vaccination rate is equal to that, while the populations in the other simulations can be thought of as not being diligent enough when it comes to vaccination, with vaccination rates that are lower than the required herd immunity percentage. As we can see, lower vaccination rates often fail to completely eradicate the disease, and that's why finding the herd immunity value can be so useful. For example, data shows that in the past, measles had an R0 value of around 5.9 in rural areas of the United States, but 10.7 in urban areas of the United States, and 14.4 in Great Britain. Using our knowledge, we can find that these correspond to required vaccination rates of 83%, 91%, and 93% respectively. This is why complete eradication of measles has been so difficult. Imagine a scenario where, in your developing country that is plagued by a long-term endemic, you lack the technology to track each infected case and directly find out what R0 is for each infected person. Hence, you need an alternate way of finding out R0 in order to save your country. Luckily, the average age at which patients catch the disease can be tracked more easily, and that can help determine R0. This is our second application, using average age of infection to find out R0. We won't go into too much of the math behind this, but it turns out that with A being the average age of infection and L being the life expectancy, A is equal to L over R0 minus 1. This makes sense, as first of all, an endemic can only exist if R0 is larger than 1, because the disease needs to be continually spread to more people, even when not everyone in the population is susceptible. Secondly, the more infectious the disease is, the earlier a newborn person will be likely to catch it. And this is shown in the equation, as the larger R0 is, the smaller A is. Rearranging the equation, we can see that R0 is just life expectancy divided by age of infection plus 1. Let's look at our simulation again with the average age of infection showing, and also the average lifespan, pretending that we don't have the facilities to directly know the R0 value of 3.5. We can try plugging the average lifespan and age of infection in, which seems to be around 100 days and 40 days respectively. What do we get? 3.5. We can also look at the real-life example of measles again. During the 1950s and 60s in England and Wales, the average age of contracting measles was 4.8 years old, and the average life expectancy was around 70 years old. 70 divided by 4.8 plus 1 is around 15.6, which is relatively close to the aforementioned R0 value of 14.4 that was observed in Great Britain. Many common diseases, such as measles and chickenpox, are always around in a population and fluctuate year to year in terms of their number of cases. And so the third application of epidemiology that we'll cover is finding out the interepidemic period in an endemic, or the approximate time between each wave of cases for that disease. Again, we won't explain all the math, but the period is equal to 2 pi times the square root of the average age of infection times the average duration of infection. With our simulation's age of infection that is 40 days, and its infection duration of 20 days, the result we get from the equation is equal to around 178 days. Rewinding to look at the period between the disease's oscillating waves, the period is in fact close to 178 days. Looking at the example of measles again, if we take the age of infection of 4.8 years in England and Wales and assume that the infectious period is around 2 weeks, which equates to about 1/26th of a year, then putting those numbers into the equation tells us that during that time, they should have had a wave of measles every 2.7 years or so. There are many more useful models and applications in epidemiology, but this is as far as we'll go in this video. Much of the information here, including the statistics for measles, came from the book Mathematical Epidemiology by Bauer, Driesch, and Wu, which goes into way more detail.